Agriculture and food production have played a big role in many of the country's economic woes of late, as the country remains dependent on imports for the most basic of things, and now with the inflationary environment. Now, one way to speed up self-reliance and efficient food production is innovation in agriculture. And here to speak to us about this is Professor Roy Kempis. He's the director at Center of Business Innovation. Good afternoon and welcome to the program, Professor Kempis.
Good afternoon.
It's good to have you here. Now, today's inflation woes are agriculture in nature. The challenges are monumental, as we cannot catch up with the food needs of this country if we do things the old way. Enter innovation. Expound for us why there is a need to innovate in our agriculture.
There is a need for innovation in the sense that we have to produce more of our agricultural products. Although our farmers already knowledgeable of technology, and they are already supported by government in terms of technology and budgetary support through credit programs of the government. There is an important aspect of the market where there is so much layering in the market structure of our agricultural sector, to the extent that these layers do not necessarily perform the functions of adding value. Instead, prices are elevated because of these additional layers in the market structure. There is a need, especially in the rice sector, which has a weight of about 8 to 9% of our inflation. And last September, the rate, I think, went up to 17% inflation in the rice sector. So we have to limit the number of layers in the market structure.
Okay.
To the extent that I think government has to rein in the rice milling and trading sector of our industry.
Okay, Professor, when you talk about the processes, the layers that you mentioned that's been considered the stumbling blocks for a more efficient agriculture production, you're talking about processes.
Yeah.
Which process?
And it starts with rice milling. Mm-hmm. Rice milling. There are even rice millers who buy rice for their own consumption from single pass or kiskisan types of rice mills.
Yeah.
Because their rice mills run the milling process at least twice in order to produce white, shiny rice, for example.
Okay.
And we have brands called Sinandoming, Dinorado, Aromatic Rice, or Pandan Rice, but there are no varieties actually associated with these brands. So there is too much branding in the agricultural sector, especially with our staple food. So prices go up because of these processes, which are unnecessary.
Right. So we have these processes that we need to get rid of. You see great potential in technology in deciding on these matters and, of course, accelerating the way we level up on food productions. What solutions are you seeing?
The other part of the solution has something to do with reining in on the consumer behavior. For the consumers to be educated as far as their purchases of fancy rice, because basically these are just fancy. They do not reflect the value coming from the varieties of rice.
Okay.
As to the other interventions that have to deal with innovation, it has something to do with, in the case of organizing farmers into more productive organizations, they need some assistance in terms of leadership in their cooperative sector, in their cooperatives.
Okay.
We cannot depend on them only. Some more educated farmers need to be part of the cooperative sector. among farmers.
Okay, I'd like to talk about farmers later. So you've established this scenario where you have production techniques, you have the farming, and then you have the consumer into play when you talk about factors, supply and demand of rice and food. You use a study of macro and microeconomics to determine the outcomes when all of these factors interplay, especially when it comes to production, the costs, and even the prices. How are these going to work in terms of planning better our food supply strategies?
I have a personal project for this. In fact, I am talking about a tracking and reporting system of prices for farm gate prices, wholesale, and retail prices. Of course, the Department of Agriculture and the DTI, including the PSA, are monitoring prices. But I was surprised that the Department of Agriculture focused on the Bantay Presyo Program, which collects data on price information on the public markets, and even supply the farmers with data from this, when in fact the DA and the DTI should get also data directly from the farmers.
Okay.
The idea of the project is to get directly the data from the farmers using technology, AI, and data analytics in order to understand that for every price point, there is a corresponding production or selling volume of commodities being sold. Apparently, there is a disconnect between our price information and the amount of volume of supply that is being sold in the market.
Okay, so here's another disconnect. We now have strategy, we have technology, and we have science on the one side. And on the other side, let's talk about human capital now. That is an important part of the equation. Okay. Agriculture organizations have for decades sounded the shortage, the alarm bells for the shortage of farmers. While many from this generation have pursued careers outside agriculture, what is the strategy now to bridge the human capital gap?
We have to share the information among our farmers that there is a prospect for going into agriculture. As far as motivation or incentives for farmers to stay in farming is to provide a price regime that is advantageous to the farmers, not only to the consumers, because we are also conscious of the inflationary effect of our price policies. But if you are going to take care of the prices of farmers, they will have the incentive to stay and encourage even their own sons and daughters to continue the tradition of being part of the development and further development of their farms. So part of that is education, and the education process was affected by the devolution of the agricultural extension services of the government, which was taken away from the Department of Agriculture, and it was vested in the local governments. However, when this happened, there were a lot of problems because of priorities in the local governments, and agriculture was not necessarily the priority of many local government units. So we have to revive the virtue of agricultural extension and reskill our workers in the offices of the agriculture, offices of the local governments, so that they can address the requirements of our farming communities.
Okay. Lastly, sir, please tell us about your group, what it does to put all of these solutions together and help our ailing agriculture sector.
Yeah. We connect with other groups. My office connects with other groups. And yesterday, I just connected with the Coalition for Agri-Modernization in the Philippines. So we are talking of common grounds for the improvement of the agricultural sector. And we are not only talking of agriculture per se, but other industries that can help improve the agricultural sector, including renewable energy. Because eventually, the use of lands for solar power, for example, will affect the available lands for agricultural purposes. So we must have a balance of using these lands for other purposes and stick to the idea and pursue the requirements of more food for Filipinos.
All right, Professor Roy Kempe is Director for Center for Business Innovation. I appreciate so much your insights. Hope to have you again on the program to check out progress in what you do. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you and welcome.